Welcome to Endress+Hauser. Welcome to this webinar about Ethernet APL, smart, fast, and digital. My name is Axel Eitmann, and I will guide you through this online session now within the next 45 minutes. From the background, I'm working actually at Endress+Hauser in Switzerland at our headquarters as a trainer for digital communication. And at the moment, I'm actually here in Australia in Sydney. So that's why it's quite easy for me to hold the seminar now in your time zone. What are we going to talk about? The next 45 minutes is this new technology, Ethernet APL. And what you already can see here in the background is actually a picture of our new training facility where we are having all these new technologies. And especially what I would like to focus on is this part of the picture, because here you can see our PROFINET wall. And if you have a close look, there's actually a little temperature device, which we are live connecting to later, for example, to its inbuilt web server, as this is one of these Ethernet APL devices. Actually, it's still a prototype, so let's hope everything works. Can you click in the presentation, please? Perfect. So what is the trend at the moment in the industry? Why are we moving at all to this new technology? Why do we need it? You know, all this automation pyramid where we have the field devices somewhere installed, talking to a DCS system on a, let's say, quite proprietary way, whether it's 4 to 20 milliamp hard signals or Profibus PA, foundation field bus. So many different technologies are there. They all have some benefits and, of course, some disadvantages. But when it comes to topics like digitalization, the Namur open architecture, data-driven decisions, the second channel, industry of things, industrial Internet of Things, IIoT, or Industry 4.0, we are sometimes suddenly now talking about data, which is actually still already available, but we don't have access to. And that we don't have access to is due to the fact that everything on top here speaks Ethernet, but we are at the bottom here speaking something else. And always when you have to convert, go from a local non-Ethernet based technology to a technology like HART or Profibus, you have to put in engineering, you have to put in a lot of additional effort, let's say, to unlock this data. And to overcome this, we thought, hey, it's time to bring this Ethernet now into the field network, that we maybe come up in the end with such a structure where everything can be connected to each other. If we have a look shortly again to where we are coming from in the history, you see we had this pneumatic system, if you may still remember them. I'm too young for that. When I was starting my work life, let's say around about 20 years ago, the electrical signals were typically already with 4 to 20 milliamps. HART was available. And as you could see, we were moving towards digital communication with the introduction of the field buses, Profibus DP, later came Profibus PA as well, and Foundation Field Bus. We already have access to a lot of information. We get additional information like diagnostics out, purely actually only in the DCS, in the control systems, but the complexity was building up, and it was getting more complex. Of course, we cannot increase all the time the complexity because we have to handle these systems somehow. So that means we need something that continues this way, but will hopefully reduce this complexity again. As I already mentioned, we have these different technology widely accepted all around the world used down here. Everything above we are using and plant Ethernet, an enterprise system. Maybe you're using Salesforce or an SAP system, and that is all, let's say, working on Ethernet. So you know the standard RJ45 connector, which you can use as well for your TV at home, or you have a Wi-Fi network. That's all Ethernet. And over here, the engineering stations, the operator stations, typically nowadays, they are all, since many years, connected over Ethernet. But down here, no. We stuck here with a low speed. We do not have this seamless data integration, and we have to consider always, do I have the correct driver? Which driver do I need? For which system do I need a specific driver? And it was quite a bit of a nightmare. So quite complex, and that we'd like to reduce now. The solution here, which we think is the success now of this trend to get more digital, is this new technology called Ethernet-APL. And we want to reduce its complexity. For example, when it comes later to the device configuration, why don't use a standard tool like any web browser? What you're completely used to opening a web page, why not opening a web page of a field device now? Now, for those of you who are already a customer for a long time with Endress+Hauser, more than 20 years, I would say now, you might remember that even Endress+Hauser had a technology called Intensor. You don't find it anymore in the market. It was not successful because it was not an open and worldwide harmonized standard. It was something special to Endress+Hauser. Didn't succeed in the market. What succeeded in that time was the HART technology. HART came from Emerson. And as you know, we still have HART around. And the reason is it is open, standardized, everybody can use it. So for Ethernet-APL now, we did the same. First of all, we need a lot of partners to bring such technology to the market. And as you can see, different companies, Emerson, Endress+Hauser, Vega, Yokogawa, and many more were working together now. They built a consortium that committed themselves to, yes, together we will bring up a new technology, and that it is accepted. It's not a solution by Endress+Hauser or by Siemens purely. It's a group-wide, worldwide approach here to the market. Now, on top of this physical layer, as we see later, we have different applications running, and they are represented by so-called organizations like the PI. They are responsible for the PROFIBUS or PROFINET technology, the OPC UA Foundation. Maybe you're using as well this technology used a lot for the second data channel, this open architecture. The ODBA representing the Ethernet IP technology, and the Fieldcom group also partnering up here, responsible for the HART technology and Foundation Fieldbus, but as well for a new driver technology called FDI. Come back to that later. So what did we do? We all were working together and we created a new standard. And that is part of this IEEE 802.3CG, actually. That's the extension, or the technical name, 10 base T1L. That is the expression now for this Ethernet APL. So a two-wire Ethernet with long cable distances as well. Additionally, an IEC TS679-47 is, let's say, taken into account. We're following this, and that's the so-called two-wire intrinsically safe Ethernet. So Ethernet APL consists out of this specification plus this specification, and that means you can use this Ethernet APL technology as well in hazardous area. For the process automation industry, a very huge requirement. Beside that, so-called port profiles were specified for the power concepts, which cable to use, which connectors to use. So this has been standardized here as well. If you look at these three first parts, you could say, okay, hey, Endress+Hauser, that's all you need. Go and develop a device. And that's actually what we are doing now. But there are the end customers, there's you that have to use this technology. And we were thinking, it is important to give you as well something to implement this technology to make it a successful start. So therefore, we were writing a so-called APL engineering guideline, which supports you starting from the planning, how to set up such a system, how to even lay out the cables, how to consider electromagnetic disturbances, how to maintain, how to measure maybe even, or what is to measure in such an Ethernet APL network. So everything actually to use this technology for you as an end user is also at hand ready. Now, in the history, we sometimes were facing issues when connecting too many different vendors together. This, of course, we also like to avoid. So therefore, so-called APL conformance tests have been specified, and every device that will be launched to the market will have to fulfill the requirements of passing such a conformance test. That means it is guaranteed, ensured, that a device from Endress+Hauser and a device from Vega can be connected, for example, to a field switch later from Peplow and Fuchs, and that's communicating maybe then over PROFINET or over Ethernet IP to an Rockwell system or over PROFINET to a Siemens control system. So the integration, the technology, PROFINET or Ethernet IP is tested and certified here as well. The physical layer is additionally now certified for each instrument. What is this Ethernet APL offering us now? If we compare it with the existing technologies like hard field bus technologies like Profibus PA or Foundation Field Bus and the standard Ethernet as you know it from the office, then you will see hard was at half duplex, 1.2 kilobit. Don't try to stream a movie with that or even listen to music. It's not working. You all have most likely experienced it already to download all the device parameters into a PDF report from a level device. Contains typically 500 to 600 parameters. You can have a big cup of coffee, like waiting half an hour until you have created this PDF. It's not because of the technologies are bad. It's the street which you are using. This 1.2 kilobit in half duplex is so slow. With Ethernet APL, we are here at 10 megabit in a full duplex way, so a lot faster, meaning you click create device report and then you have the device report. The cable is actually the same as you can see here, type A cable and here type A cable again. So that means when implementing this new technology, you were thinking, hey, it is important that you might upgrade or retrofit your plant, and you don't want to pull out new cables through your whole installations. You cannot use the cables for 4 to 20 milliamp because there is a wide variety available. It's not clearly specified what to use, but here it is standardized, and you can use now the same field bus cable for Ethernet APL as well. The distances which you can cover in a Profibus PA or Foundation Field Bus segment is the non-hazardous area, for example, up to 1,900 meters in total. That means typically we were seeing a trunk line of 700 meters and spur lines of 120 meters. Now, in the Ethernet APL world, we later have a trunk line of up to 1,000 meters, plus each single spur line can be up to 200 meters long. Also, the connectors are specified now. In a lot of devices, we had this polarity independency, but it was optional. Not every vendor, let's say, was really following this here. Now it is mandatory that it is tested, and that means when you install it, you can make a mistake, plus and minus, reverse connect it, still it will work, it will communicate that is tested and working here. We have the intrinsically safety options. You know, with field buses, it was as well possible to go into the hazardous area. You needed a special field barrier, or maybe you already had a segment coupler with an X outlet, let's say, to go into the hazardous area. Here's the same later, as you can see, directly from such a field switch, you could go into hazardous areas, for example. And the big advantage here now is we will have one technology, Ethernet, to communicate from SAP down to the temperature device, pressure, or level device. So Ethernet APL is nothing else than a new physical layer if you have a look at this IIoT module. To explain you shortly what that means for us, you can run any application what you like up here. That means you can run a PROFINET application or Ethernet IP for the Rockwell environment as example, or Modbus TCP. At the same time, because it's Ethernet, you can do a lot of things in parallel. You can have here standard applications like opening a web server, for example, for the device configuration, or sending data to a cloud application while using the PROFINET or Ethernet IP technology to communicate to a control system. Depending on the application, you might use a TCP IP or UDP IP communication through this IIoT module, and then we see here we have this Ethernet APL, just a new physics. Some devices might be available with a standard Ethernet when they are externally powered, like the big flow meters from Endress+Hauser. But in the future here, we're talking about devices in the hazardous area powered over the Ethernet and communicating over the same two wires. So Ethernet APL is just a new physical layer, let's say a new road, which you can use to bring Ethernet to the latest sensors down in the field. Here you see in short acronym SPE, single pair Ethernet. Single pair Ethernet is actually available for a longer time already. So there are different versions of single pair Ethernet established as well in the market for different requirements. Now, the single pair Ethernet, which is needed in the process automation industry with the long cable runs, use it in the hazardous area and so on, that's the version called Ethernet APL. Coming shortly back to the connection and to the specification as well of the cable. As I mentioned before, the cable, you can use your existing Profibus PA or Foundation Fieldbus cable. That is defined as a so-called type A cable in an IEC 61158-2. So the same cable specification was taken now and defined for Ethernet APL. From the connection side, screw or spring clamp terminals can be used. That has been standardized. And as well, an M12 or an 8 connector. Now, I only can suggest you or emphasize, please use these M12 connectors, because when they are pre-installed by the manufacturer and then you have to exchange the device, you don't have to pull the cable out of the device. That means you do not have to open the cable clamps. And you most likely have already experienced that if you open and closed too many times and cable clamps, maybe the ceiling gets not closed properly anymore. You might get water inside the device. Nothing to blame the technology, just mechanically, these things are not made to be opened all day long and closed again. So what I would suggest you, when you often have to take a device out of operation, for example, for calibration purposes or to clean the instrument, hey, why don't you directly go for an M12 connector? On the other hand, you can order cables with such an M12 connector pre-configured. That means you do not have to self-assemble them in the field. These industrial cables you can pull out through your whole plant, and then when you have to disconnect the device, just unscrew it, and when you have finished working on the device, screw it back in. That's it, and you have a good connection. Let's have a closer look now what Ethernet APL really brings us here in this case. As you can see, here is a flat hierarchy. We have here an Ethernet connectivity, an Ethernet network beside a control system, an asset management tool like the FieldCare software, but as well an operator station with a web client, for example. And they are, let's say, all connected on the standard 100 megabit full duplex Ethernet network. This 100 megabit Ethernet network can only be up to 100 meter long. If you, of course, go to a fiber optical connection, up to 2 kilometers distances can be bridged. But the devices always need to be at least externally powered. Now let's start with Ethernet APL. And what do we need to come from the standard Ethernet to Ethernet APL is we need a switch, and so-called APL field switch. And as you already can see, these field switches can be installed in the hazardous area in zone 2. So the field switches that are already available in the market today, like from Peppel and Fuchs, can be installed here in zone 2. Depending on the version which you have, they have outlets here, either in blue or in black. So if they are blue, it means for its intrinsic safety. That means you can install now the field device, for example, in zone 1, while perhaps the sensor inside the tank then is in zone 0. Typically, the electronics and everything is, let's say, outside of the pipeline, outside of the tank, where we have the condition of zone 1. So each spur line now to each single device here can be up to 200 meter long. It's the same over here. And all these devices here now get power over this Ethernet APL cable. So the power is provided to them by this APL field switch. Some devices need more energy, like a big Coriolis flow meter or a big MAC meter. They have to be externally powered to perform their measurement. So that means, as you can see here, you can have these devices as well externally powered, while still they communicate here then over this APL cable to the field switch. So it might be that some device vendors have instruments that still needs to be externally powered, as it is in the Profibus PA or Foundation Fieldbus world. Or if you think back to the old 4 to 20 milliamp devices, exactly the same. Now, that type of topology is very likely that we will see within the next 1 or 2 years, definitely. That means you have to place such a field switch, depending on the version which you buy, and certain amount of spurs are available, and that is placed somewhere around in your field, maybe close to a tank farm, close to your process. Then you run a standard Ethernet fiber optical cable or copper cable to your process control system, and you have like a star topology now towards all your instruments, sensors and actors, of course. We are talking here about a point-to-point connection, and this point-to-point connection is running with 10 megabits per second. With the help of this 10 megabits per second, it's fast enough that, for example, you open a web server of this instrument from up here. At the same time, you're communicating maybe over an edge device in a cloud application. Here, the cloud is as Natillion displayed. That's the Endress+Hauser cloud, which you can use then for starting with this big data things. So to collect more information from the process besides sending a process value directly here to an automation system. In the future, let's say in 2 or 3 years, the possibilities will be extended. I know companies like Pebble and Fuchs are already working on it. They might have even first prototypes under test, but not a product, let's say, available in the market today. That will allow us later to have a so-called APL power switch. And as you can see, he is now powering everything that goes down here into the field. So these APL field switches over here, they are powered over this trunk. And this whole trunk line can now be up to 1,000 meters long. Again, additionally, each spur line, which is displayed here now, can be up to 200 meters long. So big installations are getting possible. As a next level, these APL field switches might still be externally powered, and then we are talking about here a so-called unpowered trunk. And an unpowered trunk also can only be 1,000 meter long between two participants. If you would have a third APL field switch here, externally powered as well, you can place another cable to here, and then you have suddenly 2,000 meters. So the unpowered trunk concept can be extended and extended. Really huge installations can be achieved. Now, please consider the following. If you have quite a lot of instruments here, and now they are all talking with this 10 megabits per second, at one point this trunk line might get too full. And of course, you have to provide enough power from here to have everything down here powered, or when the field switches are externally powered, then typically it is enough power. But still consider the net load you are creating within this 10 megabit network. So that is the topology we are going to face, or the Ethernet APL technology is offering us what's getting possible. As mentioned in the beginning, for the next year, or let's say the next 2 years, we will mainly see these type of installations, because that's where we already today have products available. Here's a screenshot now of a product from Pebble and Fuchs, which is already available. These APL field switches have between 8 and up to 24 ports. That means up to 24 devices can be connected to a single unit here. Here, this yellow is a standard Ethernet cable, or below, you could connect a fiber optical cable. As well, other companies like Stahl or Phoenix Contact are working on bringing products to the market. I hope as well that they are soon releasing their products, because as higher the variety is in the market, as more interesting, of course, it gets for us. In the future, we will have products looking similar to this. Still, that are all prototypes, where we will have the possibility to have such a power switch, and then these APL field switches powered over the trunk line. And in the future, maybe even they are externally powered, and then we can have unpowered trunk lines for really, really huge installations. Let me focus shortly on the product which is already available in the market, this APL field switch here from Pebble and Fuchs. As you can see, it has a very nice feature on board, because at the moment, these devices, these Ethernet APL devices, are not yet ready for the market, are not yet open to order. this will take a couple of months more. Beginning of next year, you can start to order them. At the moment, we have the Profibus PA technology in place and a lot of instruments featuring this Profibus PA technology, not only from Endress+Hauser, also from other vendors. And this APL field switch now has an inbuilt Profibus PA master. So what's happening? As soon as you connect the device, for example, a Profibus PA device, the port here tries to communicate to the field device. And the field device acts in a certain way when it is connected, and that is auto-detected. And then he will say, oh, okay, I'm connected now to a Profibus device. I need now to, let's say, use the Manchester bus power technology, that's for Profibus, to talk Profibus to this device. Now, maybe you are upgrading then your plant to an Ethernet-APL device, and then the port will say, oh, the link is re-established, but I see now I can talk Ethernet to this device. So it's then talking Ethernet-APL to the device automatically. So a very good solution, especially now for the beginning of this new technology. If you want to be one of the starters here with us together, and in combination with this Pebble and Fuchs field switch, you can have the full variety of digital communication within all devices hooked up to this field switch, and step by step, for example, you can then extend to the native, let's say, Ethernet-based instruments. Now, when we are using these native Ethernet-based instruments, maybe they're installed here in a hazardous area. Okay, be aware, don't use your mobile phone in the hazardous area. But let's assume it's okay here. In this case, maybe it would be better to have here a black line and not a blue line, actually. So this device might have an inbuilt Bluetooth connectivity. That means you can use your smartphone directly to connect to a device and configure it. Quite convenient. You don't need to think about any DTM driver technology or EDD anymore, because you just use your smartphone to commission the device. Of course, service interfaces are as well still present. That means such a field expert from Endress+Hauser, for example, you can hook up locally to the instrument and communicate with the device and perform the whole device configuration. But at the same time, these instruments have inbuilt web servers now. Because it's on Ethernet level, that means from any computer, let's say, where you are running a browser on, and if it's in the same network, you can just open the web page of the device and then use the web server to configure this device. You even can detect the topology, how these devices connected, to which port later this instrument really is connected on this field switch. That's what I'm going to show you later as well live. Now, for those of you who are used to work with a software called FieldCare for asset management, or you might have a Symantec PDM, a FIM from ABB, PRM, Yokogawa, or AMS maybe from Emerson. Now, of course, you want to keep these tools and continue to use them. In the future, we will come out with so-called FDI packages. And with in the future, I mean beginning of next year, all new instruments from us will be coming with a so-called FDI package. So a huge advantage is here, independently of which control system or host configuration tool you are using here, this FDI package, the single package, can be implemented. So that allows you to have just one driver package that fits to all different systems here for the device configuration. Now, when it comes to the cyclic integration, in case of PROFINET, for example, we will support the following: that we have an Endress+Hauser specific driver, a GSD, but that will be built according to the PROFINET PA profile 4. Actually, the current version is 4.02. At the same time, the controller could decide, or the automation programmer, let's say, can decide, oh no, I don't want to use this Endress+Hauser profile, Endress+Hauser driver, I'd like to have a vendor neutral driver here. That means he can use from the Profibus and PROFINET international organization, from the PI, and so-called vendor neutral GSD file. Now the cool thing is, if you exchange this instrument here from Vega to Siemens to ABB to an Emerson device and then to an Endress+Hauser device, you don't need to change anything of the driver here while you're using this profile, this vendor neutral driver. Of course, you don't get all the process values into the system, only that what is common across all vendors from each device type here then is included then in the, let's say, automation side here. One other huge advantage when we are talking now about this Ethernet technology and whether it is Ethernet IP or PROFINET is offering us, with the help of these drivers, you can store a device configuration in your automation system. So that means, let's say this temperature device, you need to calibrate it. You take it out of your process, put it to a calibration station. In between, you bring in a replacement device. You just connect it here to this network. The PLC will detect it, will start to communicate it, will assign, for example, in the case of PROFINET, a PROFINET name to it, an IP address, and a device configuration fully automatically. In the same way, in an Ethernet IP environment, it will work as well. So the switch might assign the correct IP address to the device. The device is identified by the controller by its IP address, and from the controller, then automatically the device configuration is written down to this instrument. That makes device exchange a lot easier. These are features which you can use, but there's not a must. So it's optional. We are going to support this, of course, and the choice is in the end up to you. So as you can see, the Ethernet technology brings quite a lot of possibilities here to you. You just have to know how to use these features, and compared to a Profibus or Foundation Fieldbus environment, it's reducing the complexity quite a lot. What will be available for you by the beginning of next year from Endress+Hauser? We will have different flow devices, level, pressure, for also for differential pressure, for example, and temperature devices ready for you. Not only, of course, the hardware, the instruments will be available for you. Additionally, we will have software packages available, like for field care, this FDI interpreter. So you can use your existing field care and still use the DTM technology for your existing instruments, but at the same time, we are enabling, of course, the software to handle these FDI packages as well. And as well, in connectivity to the cloud applications, for example, for PROFINET, for Ethernet IP, we already actually have it, is then available. Keep in mind, the first instruments, all what is displayed here, will come with the application, with the technology PROFINET on board, onto the market, because we as Endress+Hauser have decided that that's the technology which we are going to support first. The second step, Modbus TCP will implement it in this product portfolio. And of course, as well, Ethernet IP is coming, is following as well. So what is now the advantage here? Very shortly, that's PROFINET specific, but what is going to be supported by these Ethernet APL devices, system redundancies, topics that the device can, let's say, talk to two controllers. Let's say if one controller fails, the backup controller automatically takes over, and kind of bumpless, you still have the informations inside your automation system. We are following this PA profile 4 in this case here. We have these web servers embedded. Heartbeat is embedded in all of our products. If you'd like to learn more about this Heartbeat technology, don't hesitate to contact us later. And as well, we have this FDI driver packages for you ready. So I would say enough talking now with the presentation. Let's have a look in the real world how this could look like. If we could shortly start with the Pronator software package. Could you go to the here it comes. Perfect. Thank you very much. So that's now standard IT, actually, what's happening in the background. As you can see, we are using here a software from Siemens, which is a freeware software. And here you see this field switch from Papillon Fuchs, and it has a certain amount of ports, or let's say spur lines available. And in this case, on spur line number 12, the Endress+Hauser temperature device, still a prototype, but a running prototype, is connected. And we see directly this cable goes from port number 12 to port number 1. Okay, our device here only offers us one port. but we have an up-to-date live topology. What else is nice with the Ethernet technology is we can read out these instruments. So I see, okay, it's a device type TMT86, it has a certain IP address, it's coming from Endress+Hauser, so far so good. But what's always interesting is, when was it installed? Maybe is it on a certain location? Is it on a certain firmware version? Has it a certain serial number? All this information are immediately available for you. So get an overview about your installation, about your plant by just clicking once, scan the network. Pretty cool. That wasn't possible with HART, Foundation Fieldbus, or Profibus at all. Now, the second part which I would like to show you is that we click, here directly to the web browser. And as you can see, it's just entered the IP address of this instrument. We are already logged in, and that's how the web page is going to look. Still, it's a prototype. In the future, we will have over here in help section, you can change your role, so different users can be configured here. You even can change, of course, the language. We stick here now to English. English, because that's what everybody is here understanding in Australia. Just as an information for you, what we can see, if you click here shortly on the guidance menu, we have a setup and wizard embedded that leads you then through the whole configuration of the instrument, but some more interesting parts as well. If you click back to the house, in the menu then we have a chapter called system. And down on the system, as you can see, you can start to configure something like a date and time. So, hey, cool, he has a clock on board now. Or you have geolocations. You can write GPS data to it, either manually or when you're connected to it with your phone, just take the GPS from your phone. And then you can easily identify the device later, find it, trace it back in your installation. Imagine you have a big plant. It would be cool if you can find your device again based on its GPS location. So all these things are getting suddenly possible, same like firmware update, downgrade if necessary, downloading a device driver that fits to the existing firmware version in this device into your automation system, all on board directly with just, let's say, opening a web browser. Good. That were the, let's say, practical parts which I was planned to show to you. And I wonder, my colleagues in the background now, let us see, is there a question or how are we doing? Okay, it seems there are some questions. Maybe you can read them out loud.
Yep, thank you, Axel. So the first question is, will the whole E&H product portfolio be available with an Ethernet APL interface?
So, of course, our development resources are as well limited. We do not have millions of people programming and designing new instruments. So, step by step, the whole product portfolio is going to be available with the Ethernet APL technology on board, including the different technologies like PROFINET, Modbus TCP, and Ethernet IP. But not by 1st of January, everything is available. Step by step, our portfolio will be extended here.
Okay, and so the next question is around delivery. So do you expect delivery issues regarding chip shortage in January?
So in January, here I'm pretty sure we do not expect any shortage of chips. But as we know, in the whole world, the situation is quite a bit, let's put it, say, tricky. So at the moment, we are still good. We have what we need in stock. But if you say now, and I come and order 100,000 devices, I would love to deliver them to you. But that might cause then at one point issues. So it is depending on how many customers worldwide are going to implement or order these instruments that are available then in the first row. Nevertheless, depending on how much is going to be ordered, we have a lot on stock and we are going to, let's say, be here ready to provide you on time with our instruments. I hope this answers the question. Of course, I cannot guarantee it to you. Maybe there's a big customer coming telling, hey, I want 20,000 devices. And then another customer comes and wants as well 20,000. And then it's really getting at one point tricky.
Perfect. And the last question is, do I have to use the web server for device configuration, or can it also be disabled?
Yes. With the Ethernet technology, a lot of things are getting possible. All onboard, let's say, communication ways can be disabled, of course. That means if you don't want someone to use the web server of a temperature or a pressure device, over the configuration, you can disable this interface. The same accounts as well for a Bluetooth or a Wi-Fi interface, which these devices might have on board. They will always offer you the communication to the control system. And in the control system, you can configure the controller in a way that when he starts to talk to the device, that then immediately, for example, the device is parameterized, and with this parameterization, a web server is disabled. For example, the device is locked that no one really can change the parameters anymore. So these possibilities, this flexibility here is given. Good. Okay. If there are no more questions at the moment, I would say thank you very much for joining this webinar. I hope you could follow all my presentation and details. We will send out an email within the next days to you with some follow-up informations. And please, if you have any questions, if you say, hey, I want to try a device out in my plant, I need some more information, maybe I need a training for one of these technologies as well, like PROFINET or Ethernet IP or even Modbus, don't hesitate to contact us from Endress+Hauser. Here, my colleagues in Australia are ready and available for you. And hopefully I see you again, or if you have the chance to come to Europe and visit us in Rheinach in Switzerland, I'm more happy to welcome you there, of course, as well. Thank you very much for joining, and have a good day.